Good morning. And we resume proceedings with general questions. I start with question number one, Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I take this opportunity to make the Parliament aware that the First Minister has appointed me to serve the Scottish Parliament as a Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the First Minister? To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to encourage tourism in the Edinburgh, Northern and Leith constituency.
Cabinet Secretary, Fiona Hislop.
We continue to support the development of the tourism sector throughout all of Scotland, including within the Edinburgh, Northern and Leith constituency. For example, the Government provided £50,000 towards the realisation of the eye-catching Dazzle Ship, currently berthed in Leith Harbour. It's an innovative art project designed by Turner Prize-nominated artist Kiara Phillips to mark the recent centenary of the Battle of Jutland. And to help the Royal Botanic Garden, Edinburgh, remain one of the top visitors' attractions in Edinburgh, we've maintained this year's grant in aid at 15-16 levels and contributed £1.96 million towards the garden's planned refurbishment of the north-east corner of its Inverleith site.
Ben McPherson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. With many historic and interesting attractions, including those just mentioned, and the Royal Yacht Britannia, and for example, Leith Links, where the first recorded rules of the game of golf were created, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that there is significant potential to develop tourism in Edinburgh, Northern and Leith?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely. You've got the Royal Yacht Britannia, the Scottish Design Exchange, the Scottish Wildlife Trust headquarters and the Trinity House Maritime Museum, the Clan Tartan Centre at Leith Mills. So a number of places to visit. And if you look at the figures from last week where we announced that there'd been a 3% increase in the visitors going to our attractions, and that's a four-year sustained increase, there's great potential for Scotland to expand even further. And every corner of the country can benefit, and I think I've given enough advertising to the member's constituency to help in his campaign to get more tourists to come to Edinburgh, Northern and Leith.
Question number two, James Kelly.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its position is on repealing the Offensive Behaviour at Football Act.
Minister Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government has no plans to repeal the Offensive Behaviour at Football and Threatening Communications Scotland Act 2012. The recent appalling scenes at the Scottish Cup final demonstrated the unacceptable behaviour of a minority of football fans continues to be a problem. An increase in the number of charges under the Offensive Behaviour Act shows that the legislation continues to be an important tool in tackling all forms of offensive behaviour, including sectarianism, and sends a clear message that such behaviour has no place in a modern, open and inclusive society.
James Kelly.
Quite rightly, we've heard a lot of discussion over the last week about how Scotland is an open, progressive and modern country. In that regard, it seems peculiar that we have a particular piece of legislation that targets football fans when other legislation is in place to deal with such offences. This legislation is illiberal, it's caused friction between police and fans, and it's caused confusion in the judiciary. As such, does the Minister not agree with me that it's time to blow the whistle on this discredited piece of legislation?
Minister.
No, I don't agree with that, and I would question certain propositions that Mr. Kelly was putting forward just a moment ago. I would point out to the Chamber, because this may not be so well known, that in fact there is provision within the Act itself to allow amendment to improve its effectiveness. Section 5 allows for amendment to Section 1, the offensive behaviour at football, while Section 9 allows for amendment to Section 6, threatening communications. And in fact, the Scottish Government have invited stakeholders to submit evidence on how the Act could be improved. But to date, nobody has done so. So I would say to Mr. Kelly that my door is always open. It's always open to discuss how any legitimate concerns can be addressed. And that is the constructive way in which the Scottish Government will continue to address this very important matter.
John Mason.
Hey, thank you. I mean, does the Minister not agree that given what happened at the Scottish Cup final, if this Act was repealed, it would be saying that offensive behaviour was acceptable and sectarian behaviour was acceptable, and surely it is not?
Minister.
Well, I would say to the member that, of course, the aim of the Scottish Government is to prevent abusive and offensive behaviour taking place, and the 2012 Act plays an important role in this regard. And until such behaviour ceases, sadly, there will continue to be a need for the Act itself.
Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When the recent figures revealed a large increase in the charges under this legislation, the Cabinet Secretary hailed them by saying that legislation continues to be an important tool in tackling all forms of offensive behaviour. Yet 12 months earlier, when figures actually reduced, the then Community Safety Minister said, while the legislation we brought in 2 years ago has had its critics, the latest statistics show a steady decline in offences at stadiums. Can I ask which of these contradictory statements from the SNP government on this deeply unpopular piece of legislation the public should believe?
Minister.
Well, I would say to the member that surely he would also agree that it is a matter of great regret that we have seen an increase in the number of charges under the Offensive Behaviour Act most recently. And surely he would also accept that the recent appalling scenes at the Scottish Cup final demonstrated that there is indeed still a problem on the part of a minority of football fans and that we continue to need to tackle this issue.
Question number three, Stuart Stevenson.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure the sustainable future of dairy production in the north-east of Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Fergus Ewing.
Although centred mainly in the southwest of Scotland, dairy farming also occupies an important place in the economy of the northeast. As the member will know, the industry is facing a number of market-driven pressures which we've been seeking to address with stakeholders. Dairy farming in the northeast of Scotland, as in other parts of the country, can only be maintained if our excellent producers receive a fair return for their efforts. Now, whilst it will ultimately be down to the market to deliver this, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is on the front foot with a range of initiatives aimed at boosting resilience in these challenging times, including the creation of the Dairy Growth Board and supporting the online Scottish Dairy Hub. And we will also be involved in an industry-led working group that will consider what support can be given in the short to medium term.
Stuart Stevenson.
Does the Scottish Government encourage the actions of NFU Scotland, Opportunity North East and Aberdeenshire Council to commission a study into alternative dairy processing options in the North East? And if so, does it consider that that local initiative can be a vital component of ensuring support for the dairy industry in the area I represent?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I very much agree with that, and I've had the pleasure of meeting with the NFU on several occasions since I was appointed, not most recently yesterday. And I'm also conscious of Opportunity Northeast and Sir Ian Wood's extremely generous gesture of support and his interest in promoting innovation in farming. And there already is, of course, as Stuart Stevenson well knows, a huge amount of innovation in farming, especially in the dairy sector, especially in diversification into other higher profit margin products over recent years from a variety of companies. So I'm determined to work with all members and all parties and the industry in order to address the very serious challenges facing the dairy sector in Scotland at the current time.
Mike Rumbles.
Members will be aware that dairy farmers receive no subsidy through the Common Agricultural Policy. And when the Common Agricultural Policy ceases to apply, does the Minister believe that the dairy industry should be included in any scheme that he brings forward for subsidies in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
What I can say, Presiding Officer, is that since last Friday, a great many farmers and crofters, some of whom I met at the Royal Highland Show last Friday, are extremely concerned about the total lack of clarity from the UK government on the future arrangements to continue the necessary support for all our farmers. And I would repeat the message that I gave to the Rural Committee yesterday. This uncertainty, this worry, which is of such great anxiety to the farming community, it must be dispelled by the Chancellor of the Exchequer as soon as possible. EU funding is a reserved matter. It is plainly the responsibility of the UK government to come up with a plan B. And I hope that plan B is not a Christian name.
Peter Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I certainly agree that we need to see where we are going with the support payments going forward. But in in this specific proposal, the problem is that the dairy industry is under increasing pressure because of low commodity prices. And the problem here in the northeast is that the Mueller-Wiseman management have decided to add a 1.75 pence per litre haulage charge onto the already depressingly low prices that they are getting. I have written to the chief executive, pardon?
I have written to the chief executive
of Mueller Dairy asking for them to pick up this tab, and I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to support that. Because I feel that the Mueller management decided to close this factory to take costs out of their production, and they have added all the extra costs onto the dairy farmers.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary has heard your question. Cabinet Secretary.
It was difficult to discern precisely what the question was. If the question is that the Scottish Government should become intervene in contractual arrangements, then that is not the sort of question that I would expect to be the typical approach of the Conservative Party, that normally says that contractual matters are matters between the two contracting parties. Let me be clear. I was, of course, disappointed by the announcement of Mueller, but I'm also pleased that Mueller are planning an investment in Bells Hill, a very substantial investment in Bells Hill, and we must, of course, respect the right of companies to conduct their business, and it's not for me to interfere. I'm astonished that Mr. Chapman is an interventionist. I would have thought that that's something that we expected for the benches over there. But what I can confirm is that I will work very closely with all of the major players in the sector, because we are extremely concerned about the difficult times facing farmers in the dairy sector, and therefore we will work increasingly close with them to do everything we can to ameliorate the problems that they face right now.
Question for John Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it has had with the forestry and timber processing industry regarding new charging levels being phased in over the next 5 years for pollution prevention and control permits.
Cabinet Secretary Fergus Ewing.
Scottish Government officials hosted a meeting between SEPA and representatives of the timber processing industry on Monday to discuss the new SEPA regulatory charging scheme and ongoing liaison arrangements.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. However, he will be aware from my correspondence that the cost of a PPC permit will rise in Scotland by 54% in the next 5 years, from £2,320 to £3,566 per installation, while in England and Wales, similar charges have not risen this year and look to remain the same next year too. The Minister will understand that this will put timber treatment sites in my constituency at a competitive disadvantage over English sites and will disadvantage plants in Troon, Lockerbie and elsewhere in the south of Scotland, resulting in higher costs and potential job losses. Will the Government consider not imposing this punitive charging regime at this time, as it could reduce jobs in my constituency and elsewhere in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would say to the member that I am aware of these concerns, and it's quite understandable that he raises them. I understand the argument he's bringing forward. And of course, we both, I think, want to further drive forward the forestry's contribution to the rural economy, which it makes a contribution of £1,000 million a year. SEPA have brought forward a new charging regime which will simplify charging arrangements, make efficiencies, promote compliances. There will be reductions as well as increases. But what I would say to the member is this, that I'm well aware of the meeting on Monday. I know that Mr. Soman and Mr. Goodall were present. Under my and Rosanna Cunningham's oversight, there will be a workshop to explore the specific issues, to examine in particular whether the principle of cost recovery requires increases of that level, because the principle of cost recovery is, of course, the one that is applicable.
Question number five, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what measures it is taking to facilitate the growth of marine tourism in Inverclyde.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government works closely with a wide range of public bodies, local authorities, the third sector and other specialist sector advisory bodies in order to promote sustainable economic growth throughout Scotland, including sustainable marine tourism with the industry-led marine tourism strategy. Recent support from Visit Scotland in the Inverclyde area includes £13,000 from Event Scotland for the P1 Powerboat Scottish Grand Prix event held in the 18th and 19th of June, plus £10,000 for the Scotland's Boat Show, which took place at Inverkip Marina between the 9th and 11th of October last year.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. And the Cabinet Secretary will be aware of the City Deal projects, particularly the extension of the quayside at Greenock Ocean Terminal to facilitate bringing in more cruise liners. This indeed will be of great assistance, but there are still questions regarding the possible reduction in hourly trains between Greenock and Glasgow as a result of the proposed rail link to Glasgow Airport. But can the Cabinet Secretary inform me of what direction can be provided to Visit Scotland to ensure that they work in full with local partners to maximise Inverclyde's tourism opportunity, with a greater emphasis on promoting Inverclyde as Scotland's marine tourism capital?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very excited about the possibilities of marine tourism. I think it's an untapped potential. And if you look at particularly our coastal opportunities, I certainly would be encouraging Visit Scotland to make sure that we promote all of our coasts and all of our marine tourism possibilities. And as a great champion of marine tourism, we look forward to working with Stuart McMillan in that regard.
Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Cabinet Secretary knows, many tourists visit our seas like the Clyde to see Scotland's outstanding marine wildlife. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the Scottish Government must continue its job of completing the Marine Protected Area Network to preserve this wildlife, including consulting with all stakeholders and local communities on management measures such as for the Clyde Cecil MPA?
Cabinet Secretary.
The quality of our marine areas is very important to the marketing of our marine coastal areas. Clearly, marine protection is a responsibility of another member, but I think her point has been well made.
Jamie Green.
Despite the rain, I'd like to say that the P1 Boat Show was a great day out in Greenock, and thank you to everyone involved in that. Given the fact that the rest of the UK is the biggest market for marine tourism outside Scotland, accounting for 30% of all visitor boat nights, what work has been carried out with agencies and clubs south of the border to promote the beautiful sailing opportunities that exist across the West Coast and across Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, at this time in particular, it's really important to make sure that we send the message that Scotland there welcomes visitors from wherever they come, and it's important that we make sure that our tourism industry can be championed. And there's a huge amount of work promoting Scotland as the best place to come, and some of the awards that we've seen coming to our marine tourism experiences shows that Scotland is the best place to come. We remain open to visitors, whether from England or indeed elsewhere in Europe or the wider world.
Question number six, Richard Leonard.
Who asked the Scottish Government what consideration it has given to the implications of the Trade Union Act 2016 on workers in Scotland?
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Scottish ministers opposed this legislation as it made its way through Westminster. We saw this as an ideological attack on trade unions which threatened Scotland's good industrial relations record. So we lobbied the UK Government alongside trade unions and local authorities to exclude Scotland from the extent of the legislation. During this process, we looked at every possibility to oppose and restrict the implementation of this regressive legislation in Scotland. We engaged with trade unions and other parties to discuss how best to fight the bill. Scottish ministers continue to oppose the Act, although it has been watered down in places as it progressed through Westminster. We're still to see how this Act will be put into force through secondary legislation. This may still have an impact on how we are able to work with unions, and we will continue to work with the STUC to ensure that together we can mitigate the negative impacts of this legislation and protect our good industrial relations record in Scotland.
Richard Leonard.
Yeah, can I thank the Minister for that reply? The Scottish Government is an employer. Can the Minister give assurances to this Parliament that he will meet the civil service trades unions, that he will enter into written and binding industrial agreements with those trade unions that will ensure that no part of the public sector for which this government has responsibility withdraws check-off, cuts trade union facility time, or permits at any time the use of agency workers to replace workers engaged in lawful industrial action?
Minister.
Well, Well, I could hear the Deputy First Minister making the point, rightly making the point, that we have done all that. So where we have these areas of control in relation to check off and so on, we've not sought to implement them. We have good industrial relations with our trade union partners. We'll always be willing to work with them, and we will do everything we can to mitigate and work against the impact of this legislation.
Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree with me that a workplace where trade union membership is recognised and encouraged is a safer and wealthier workplace, and that the Trade Union Act 2016 could jeopardise this?
Minister.
Yes, I mean, we very much work with our trade union colleagues as partners. I'm very new to my post, Presiding Officer, but in the range of working groups and bodies that we have established that I have responsibility for working with, I think virtually every single one has trade union representation. I do recognise the benefits that Claire Hawkey sets out. This is the heart of our commitment to fair work, and particularly to the establishment of the Fair Work Convention. And as I've set out, we'll do everything we can to stymie and work against this legislation.
Thank you, Minister.